name is Elliot Curran. I fight fascism with puppets. You might have seen my King Trump puppet. He's got a crown and crazy hair, and he's published almost every month in the mainstream press. But I want to tell a true story about a true event that happened. I hope I can keep it short. After college, I joined the circus. I was working in a bookstore, and I took a lunch break, and I ran into a guy I was in a play with in college. And I said, "What are you doing in the summer?" He said, "Why don't you be a clown in the circus?" I said, "Wow." I said, "Can I go with you?" I was kind of at loose ends. And he said, "Have you ever clowned before?" I said, no, but I could do it." He said, "Can you ride an elephant?" And I said, "No problem." It's a true story. So anyway, I toured the circus, and we went down to Texas for our first date. This would have been freezing cold in March. And the owner of the show, it was a real show. We had elephants, lions, camels, ponies, a real show, about 40 people. And the owners, you know, got everybody together in the parking lot and said, you know, "Let's have a meeting." And all he said was, "Well, we all know why we're here. We're here to make a good living, so let's have a good year." And I thought, well, I gotta learn everybody's name. I'm gonna be on the road with these people for 9 months all over the country, played 25 states. And so I tried to learn everybody's name, but I learned very quickly you didn't bother to learn the workers' names. They were the flotsam and jetsam of life. They were runaways, they were criminals trying to get out of a town, they were bums, they were hobos, they were schizophrenics who wandered around. It was a whole collection, but they didn't last more than a week, most of them. They lived in metal bunk beds in a big moving van, and we had low water pressure in Texas, and first the animals got water, and then the people, the performers, could put their showers on, and then they'd hose these guys down in the company jumpsuit, this one-piece zipper thing. But we picked up a good guy early in the season in St. Louis, Missouri, and his name was Dean. I didn't know what the expression barrel-chested meant till I met him. He was so muscled, his upper body was almost round like a barrel. Mm-hmm. And he was a simple country boy, always in a good mood, and so powerful. They figured out he was strong enough, they'd give him two rubber mats and he'd load them in the truck. He didn't need much sleep. And he just quietly became part of the show. And after a few weeks, he was driving the concession truck, and he was one of us. Simple, pleasant, nice guy. I remember we were, you know, I was 21, and we'd go to the little roadhouses in Texas to pick up the local girls. And you'd go, and it was like that scene in the cowboy movie when the piano player stops and they all look at the strangers. And half the show was Mexican. You know, so it was a little tense. The local guys didn't want us around, but when Dean was there, you felt safe. He really had the strength of three men, and he was like a loyal dog. I remember one time in a disco, he drank a lot of beer, and he came up, he was in a good mood, and he said, "Hey, Elliot, how you doing?" And he slammed me on the back, and I thought, "Oh, he's broken my spine." His hands were like iron. Anyway, he stayed the whole season. Our last date was Corpus Christi, Texas. We're under the palm trees a block from the Gulf. And we did the 2 o'clock show. And a lot of the Mexicans got in their vans and headed south, and some people headed north. We decided to lay over till the next day and go back to Wisconsin. And I was sitting in my trailer, our little 12-foot trailer, reading a book called The Transformative Vision. It was published by City Lights Bookstore. And it basically, the whole New Age movement was based on the research in that book by Jose Arguelles, a fascinating book with references to Antonin Artaud and Baudelaire. And his thesis in the book was there was an unhealthy split between the function of the right hemisphere and the left hemisphere of the brain in the Renaissance. And from that time, everything was about science. And we lost the intuitive and we lost the creative. It was an amazing book given to me by a girlfriend who went on to teach art in Princeton. Anyway, so I'm reading this book, and we were laying over to the next day, and the door of the trailer's open, and Dean saunters up. And he looks up, and I figure, okay, so the concession truck is gonna hold over and go back to Missouri tomorrow morning, because Dean's here. And he looks up and he goes, "Hey, Elliot." He goes, "That's a good book." And I was stunned. If I'd asked myself, could Dean read, I'd have said, probably not. So I said, "Have you read it?" He said, "Yeah." He said, I've read just about everything ever written on the occult. And I said, you have? Now, if he read this book, this is like in the farthest neighborhoods of the occult. This is like a spiritual book. This is like, they didn't know where to put it. Is it psychology, art, history? And he read it. And I said, you have? He said, yeah, I've read just about everything ever written on the occult. That's kind of why I joined the circus. I said, it is? He said, yeah. He said, well, I guess I can tell you the story. He said, you know what a warlock is? I said, you mean like a male witch? He said, yeah. He said, well, to me and a couple of friends back in St. Louis, we were summoning, and we were practicing, and I woke up one morning, and one of my friends, he was dead, and the other one, he'd gone crazy. I don't know, he summoned something he couldn't control, and it killed him. And I had to get on the road and disperse my powers, or I'd be dead too. Now, he thought a demon was pursuing him. 9 months on the road, 25 states. I don't know if you want to believe him, but I met two other people who messed with witchcraft in my life, and it was the same story, different only by degree. Thank you.